It is so good to see you all here. We have overflow seating outside, which is, again, a testimony to the wonderful community that we have here. I would like to remind you, take a moment to silence or turn off your cell phones and your devices as the family shares recollections of Jonathan's life, his impact in their lives. We certainly don't want to be interrupted by anything like that. So, without further ado, we're going to have a reading of scripture and then some reflections on Jonathan's life.
Good afternoon. All right, I am going to be reading from Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, verse 1 through 8. There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under heaven. A time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot. A time to kill and a time to heal. A time to tear down and a time to build. A time to weep and a time to laugh. A time to mourn and a time to dance. A time to scatter the stones and a time to gather them. A time to embrace and a time to refrain from embracing. A time to search and a time to give up. A time to keep and a time to throw away. A time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace.
I'm Mary Ellen Sims. I'm so glad you're all here. It's a real tribute to my friend and my husband. I'll tell you just a little bit about him. I won't go into all detail, but Chuck was born in Fairmont, Minnesota. And his parents, Mary and Vern Sims, didn't think they were ever going to have children. And so he came on and was born on Mother's Day. I was like, so perfect. You know, he's my daughter, and I said, when he makes up his mind he's going to do something, he just does. Yeah, and he grew up on the lakes, one of the 10,000 lakes in Minnesota. I have a story. I don't know if I'm going to tell a story because Wendy said she didn't want to tell it because she cried. But when Chuck was in high school, he was kind of a bad boy. And he and his friends, the police, that was back, you have to realize, in the late 40s and early 50s, when the police would, you know, their cars, they just leave the keys in them. Well, they decided they were going to go for a ride. So they got in the police car. And then they left the car somewhere else. And the next morning on the radio, the local radio station, there was this, he was eating breakfast, and they were talking about some people came to town and stole the police car. And they were really looking for him. And he said he just looked down and kept eating. But they never did get caught. And then he had another story to tell. He had a chemistry teacher, a group of them in high school, and he was wonderful. He was really a mentor for these boys. But they decided they learned how to build bombs. So they would go at night and take the lids off of the, what do you call those? In the street, and put the bomb down there, in the hole. And then they put the cover back on. Then they go hide, and then the cover would blow off, and smoke would come out. And all the people that lived on that street just knew that the world was coming to an end. They never got caught, and of course they didn't. But he was a little bit mischievous. After he graduated from high school and joined the Air Force, he said that he got the greetings, as most of the people in our generation remember, the greetings. And he could either go into the Army for 2 years, or he could go into the Air Force for 4 years, or the Navy. Well, he had no interest in going to the Navy, so he joined the Air Force. And that began his adventures. He hadn't been out of Minnesota very many times until then. And he was stationed down in Padre Island area down in Texas. And he was in the, they didn't have an Air Force Academy at the time. And so he took all his tests and they put him into the program where they could learn, be pilots or observers. And that's what he chose to do. So he was there for about 2 years when I met him. And we met in Dallas, Texas. Interesting place to meet because his friend came and I came to see my friend. Anyway, I graduated from college in 1955 and then we got married. Got my diploma in August and got married in September. You know, those were the days where you didn't fool around. Got married. And we lived in Little Rock. We were stationed there. That's where our oldest daughter, Dixie, was born. And we named her Dixie because we figured we were leaving the South forever since she was we weren't going to stay down there. And so we named her Dixie because we were never going to go back. And when all this business came up without the word Dixie, Dixie said, "Are they going to stone me? Do I have to change my name?" But anyway, then we moved to the school in Minneapolis at the University of Minnesota, and then we went to Phoenix, where we had a job. And that's where both Jill and Wendy were born. In the meantime, my nephew, who's sitting back here, he came along about the same time Jill did. So it was nice. It was nice to have cousins. Anyway, he decided he would he wasn't going to go to university anymore. And unbeknownst to me, he changed and went to another school to get his technician. And then we moved to Arizona. I didn't know any of the schools are already done. As I said, he decided he was going to do something. He did. And then we moved to Iowa. Friend Annabelle sitting over here, and we stayed there for 16 years, was it? Yeah. We now have 5 grandchildren, 3 grandsons, 2 granddaughters. One of our great granddaughters is sitting over there with her dad, and another one of those great granddaughters is sitting over there with her dad, and then there's another one and back in Tempe. Somehow we didn't think that their dad should bring 2 of them. So she stayed home with her mother. So anyway, Chuck had a good life. He loved LBL. He was so glad that we moved here. He just enjoyed it. Didn't have to do anything he didn't want to do. And he did participate in quite a few things until he got where he couldn't do that anymore. But Chuck went to memory care in November of last year, a year ago. And I tell you, if you have to go, and we're not, anybody's not standing in line, but if that's what you're going to have to do, you're just lucky to live here because they're so good. And he was so well treated. I just, you know, I couldn't have done that. I wouldn't have been that nice. Now, I was hearing her husband was down there with Chuck, and they were very mischievous together. They were always trying to get out. So they would go outside to go out and learn, and they'd try to get open the gate. But they never did get out. But anyway, they kind of conspired. All they both could. But anyway, he did pass away on the 29th of November, and it was very quiet. And the good hospice, and the hospice is right here. Sharon over there with Sandy over there with her nurse, her nursing thing with hospice. And he was very quiet. He was not in any pain. He's going to sleep. So, isn't that the way to go?
Yes.
You know, but as my father-in-law said, when Chuck makes up his mind, he's going to do something. He just did it. So, anyway, thank you all for coming. He's a very old bit about Chuck Sims. He was really a pretty nice guy. We like, you know, we miss him. But he's better off here at this. So, thank you. If anybody else wants to talk, I would love to hear it.
Hello, I'm Missy. Well, that didn't change my name. I appreciate all of you very much. I have been loving her so much. She was so grateful to her. He was a good dad. He was an honorable man. He was always there for anyone who needed him. He was a force in many people's lives. He always was very involved in our church, with the youth group, with the Boy Scouts. And it's very well loved. And I always knew that he was there for me, and he always was. So thank you.
So one time when my husband was cleaning out our garage, he found in a pile of trash, actually, a thing my dad had typed out. And as we were children, we always, since the time I was two, we would go to Ouray, Colorado for our vacations. In fact, that's where mom and dad's ashes will go when after mom goes. So this is a little thing he had, and I just want to go over a little bit of it. These are some of my favorite memories. My dad loved flowers, he loved nature, and I'm so happy he passed that on to all of us. So our first trip was in 1963 on July 4th, and we met my father's parents there, and it was Mom, Dad, Dixie, and I. Winnie was not born yet, so it was just the four of us. And we went on a Jeep ride, and we stayed at the Matterhorn Hotel. In Ray, if you've never been there, they have a beautiful hot spring pool. So we soaked in the pool and had wonderful time. The fire, I still remember going there, and I was very young, and they had a big pile of hay, and you found money in it. And that was awesome. I think it's the only time that Dad took down the back of our Jeep wagon here and let us ride on the tailgate. Because that was something he did not do. But in there, we could. My husband and I also spent our honeymoon there. So that tells you how special of a place it is for us. We've been there with Cousin Andy and his family long ago. Some of these don't really have dates on them, so it's... We also spent my daughter's, Danielle's, first birthday there. Had a wonderful time. Oh, and we went for our honeymoon. We stayed at the Matador Hotel. We've rented houses there. We've done numerous things. One time when we went, Todd and Dad rented mountain bikes, and Dad had a little collision. And we found out the next day, of course he wouldn't go do anything that day, no, he was fine, but the next day he had actually cracked his elbow, so we decided that they would not do that anymore, we would stick to the Jeep rides.
My name is Danielle Tanner, and I am the daughter-in-law. I am the best daughter-in-law. Because I'm the only daughter. So I just wanted to tell a story about what Chuck did for me and how it just opened my life. It was one Christmas, I don't remember the year, I'm not like Andre, I can't remember, you know, exactly this year, but it was one Christmas, And we're opening presents, and I get this big present from Chuck, and I open it, and it's a bird feeder. And I said, well, thank you. I thought, and this is really hard to say, but I thought that was the dumbest present I've ever gotten in my entire life. Okay? And so, what, you know, Chuck, I always said thank you. And the next day, I noticed that Chuck is outside, right by the dining room window, and he's got this thing, and he's digging a hole, and he brings a pipe out of his van, he puts a pipe down, and he had bought all the attachments, and he sets up that bird feeder right at the dining room window. And so when I go out in the morning and drink coffee, I started seeing the birds. Well, you know, how that changed my life is that I got interested in a hobby. You know, it was all about work, and as Wendy knows, all about work, no hobby. But this turned into a lifetime hobby. And so if you look outside of my dining room window now, do you still see that bird feeder that you gave me? However, you see one over there. And a water thing that's heated in the winter time so it doesn't freeze. It has a pump for the summertime. So I've developed this whole hobby, and Wendy and I go birding a lot. We had even bought a camper so we could go out into the woods and camp and bird. And so what he gave me was something to do that was not work. Yeah. Something to do that was not work. And I will forever cherish that memory.
So I'm very lucky to have my grandparents in town. In 2009, they moved to Albuquerque here. And so they were really close. And even before that, they would like come visit a lot. So that was really cool. But I have some special memories.
It's so random.
You can do it. Take your time. Let's start here. Okay.
2012, we went to Washington, D.C., the three of us.
Stuff to the dump, and these are funny. We all crammed. So I had a silver Nissan Frontier, and we all would get in like the front seat. So we'd all squeeze into that little truck, and we'd go to Menchie's. But then the next time we all got in the truck, I had my Ford Ranger, and Papa insisted on sitting in the back, which is, if you don't know the Ford Ranger, it's this really funny little trunk seat. It's like 10 inches across. I don't know why. That's like you can fit. Whatever. And then we went. There was a World War II plane we used to like military planes, and there was one that came to Dublin when we went inside. Went inside of it. It was a nuclear museum. Yeah, just all the things and stuff, and I'm crying too much here.
I think of my grandfather. I think of how blessed I was. How blessed everybody else was.
that we got to have him in our lives. He loved. He was a fixer to follow up. Absolutely. And we did a lot of projects together. And I definitely attribute my love for woodworking, for problem solving, definitely to him. We were working on a project and one thing didn't work, just try something else. And usually it did, if not, then something else always would. I was definitely blessed to spend time with him, up until the very end. And one thing that strikes me is, on one of my last visits with him, he still brought out his flashlights. And I just sat there and we figured it out. And he was just so happy that he got those flashlights working again because somebody needed them. I have definitely been blessed to have such an amazing grandfather and an amazing family.
As been said, family is so important. The way he was brought into the family and embraced. And he did that with me because for some reason his daughter liked him. So that was good enough for him. He accepted me in and brought me into the family, or extended family. But I'm thankful to him for that. Because she definitely could have done better than me. He accepted me and brought me in and just treated me with the most respect. I appreciate that.
I'm Katie Elliott, and I met Chuck and Mary Ellen in 1975, and I was a brand new college graduate who joined Vista and went off from California, where I had family and a support system, to Iowa. What a difference. And I met a person who was going to become my husband, and that he also came from California to Iowa to be a Vista volunteer. And he was blessed in that he met Mary Ellen. And she adopted him, and by token there, I got to come as well. And Chuck and Mary Ellen became our gateway to learning how to be grown-ups. And there was so much. I think we talked about Chuck being a fixer, but he also was a teacher.
Yes.
And for us, he taught us how to be adults, how to fix those things that needed to be fixed in the house, and how to live a life of service and of accomplishment. And there was just so much there that they both did for us. And I can think of all the times when Mary Ellen and I would sit at the table in their house in Marshalltown drinking coffee and Bailey's. And Chuck and Jim would be off making something or fixing something or doing something. And it was just such a gift. And I can't imagine how my life would have been without them being the incredible support system they were. And they also then, in doing that, they shared their daughters with us. And what a gift to get to know them, to be part of their lives. And then when we would come to visit in either Austin or here, it was after just a few minutes we picked up and here we were again. And they would have that. But I think about Chuck and his correction often too, where there would be times when I kind of, he's very linear. And I'm not. And so I would throw out these hopes and dreams and things, and he'd kind of go, well, you could think of it that way. And then he'd proceed to kind of give a different option. It might work a little better. But again, my manual says, without judgment, but just, here's another way to think about it. And I just feel so blessed that we were able to have them in our lives and to be able to grow into the people we needed to be because of them. So thank you, Mary Ellen and Chuck.
Hello, I'm Annabelle, and I am the other. So Mary Ellen calls me. I'm from Marshalltown, Iowa originally, and Chuck and Mary Ellen moved to Marshalltown. They joined our church, and Mary Ellen became very good friends with my mother, and they still are to this day. They talk every Monday. And I became friends with Dixie first, and then Jill, and then Wendy. And we all know that Chuck is a fixer. He's many, many things, but first and foremost, he is a fixer. I heard somebody reference today about the flashlights. He fixed toasters, he fixed cars, he fixed candelabras. It really didn't matter if it was broken, Chuck would fix it. But in my opinion, the best thing that he was good at fixing was people. Human spirits. And everywhere that went, he gathered people. And he gathered them because he had. So he had so much to give. And while none of us are a saint, he had the most amazing way with humans, with their souls, with their spirit. He could tell you that he didn't like your decision, but he never, ever said that he didn't like you. He could talk about how your actions were maybe not really appropriate, but he never told you that you weren't. And if you've never experienced being threatened and being told that you are nothing, you sometimes don't understand how precious that ability to validate another person is. And I really credit Chuck Sims with fixing me. I was on the brink of suicide when those guys came and really became deeply involved in our church. And without Chuck Sims as a second father, I wouldn't be here today. And that includes Mary Ellen as well, but this is for Chuck. He helped me to understand. He had such a wonderful way of looking at a situation and saying, this is a problem, and we must solve this. But he always understood and believed that there were solutions. I didn't believe that there was any solution at that point in my life. But he helped me to see that there were. And he would say, okay, you got yourself into a little pickle. Now let's just figure out how we're going to get out of it. And nobody in my life had ever dealt with a problem or a crisis or a tragedy with that evenness, with that just ability to say, circumstances are wrong, but you're not. We maybe don't love what you're doing, but we still love you. And that is the essence of family and friendship. And what is, he helped me to understand that that's still out there in the world. And what I love the most about that is that it has extended to everyone in his family. And I see that in how Dixie and Todd raised their children, and how Tracy and Jill raised theirs,
I see it and how the mountain went to grace fails. And now I see it with grandchildren and Vance and Eli. All of you helped me to understand what family truly is. And Chuck is just a remarkable, amazing man. And I'm really honored to have called him my second. Godspeed, Chuck.
My name is Tracy. I'm Joe Fliffman. And we made a trip once down to Texas. We spent a good week there in a house. And it was their 50th wedding anniversary. And I always liked Texas. So in thinking of that and keeping with, I wanted to play a song. I didn't want to play something sad. I didn't want to play something soppy. Because again, we're here to celebrate Chuck's life. So are you guys familiar with Austin City Limits, obviously, right? So they got a little theme song at the beginning of it there that I used to play with some guys in Arizona, so I figured I'd just play that. When you're down on your luck and you ain't got a buck, London, you're a goner. Even the bridge has fallen down and moved to Arizona. Now I know why. And I'll substantiate the rumor that angel's sense of humor is drier than Texas sand. You can put up your dukes, you can catch your boots. I'll be a leaving just as fast as I can. I wanna go home with the armadillo and country music from Amarillo. Have a league, friendliest people and prettiest women you ever seen. When it's cold over here, and I swear, I wish they'd turn the heat on. Where in the world is that English girl? I promise I would meet on the third floor. And oh damn, not the only friend I got, she smoked and a cheap guitar. Mine keeps rolling, my heart keeps longing to be home in a Texas bar. I want to go home with the armadillo and country music from Amarillo. Have a league, friendliest people, prettiest women you ever seen. Decided that I'd get my cowboy hat and go down the Marble Arch Station. Texan fences, takes his chances, chances will be taken, that's for sure. Well, the blinding eyes, I'm the prize. Some people call manly footwear. They say you're from down south, you opened your mouth, you always seem to put your foot there. Wanna go home with the armadillo, your country music from the Amarillo. Have a lane, friendliest people, prettiest woman ever seen.
Two doors down from Mary Ellen and Chuck. And during the construction, the lights went on and off with some regularity. So Chuck took it upon himself to make sure that all of us knew about the red flashlights. So when the lights would go off, the doors would open on our hallway, and people in their pajamas, usually about 7 o'clock or later, because it's okay to put your pajamas on here that early. The doors would open, we all come out in the hallway with our red flashlights, blinding each other, trying to turn them on, and figure out, you know, we'd stand in the hallway and laugh, and how long is this going to happen, and you'd have water for your toilets, and so this whole corridor. But the best part is they call me kid. So even though I was 65 and they were 85 or more, I was a kid. So that was very special. I got to be part of their family. But he had a very sweet heart. And when I would be out filming on my balcony for the construction, and he was another balcony down, I'd be filming, and all of a sudden I'd start feeling like somebody was watching me. And I would turn over, and Chuck is going like this. And I'm wondering, how long has he been doing that till I pay attention? So we would have these little conversations over the balcony in between. So we got to be their kids, even though we were not born by them or even related, but they loved us anyway.
To the family I was conveying to some of you in this room, I'm Betsy Bain. I live here. I've lived here 13, 14 years. I lived in Encisa. And the Sims moved in shortly after I did. And Chuck was a fixer. Because there were times when I'd eat dinner, I'd say, oh, I've got this problem. What is it? Well, I have a chair that's broken. Oh, okay. It would be fixed. Other things happen like that all the time. And then they moved. They moved to the Nueva Vista, which was like forever away. And they didn't stay there a real long time, and then they moved down here, which was, I think, better, because Mary Ellen is a very social person, and there's lots more to do in this building than there are in any of the other communities on campus. So they tested out everything. I guess you have tested about everything, didn't you? And I agree with her. It all works. It's a wonderful place to live. And Chuck and Mary Ellen were very, very good neighbors. To me, particularly. Sorry, thank you. And I agree with you. Godspeed. Chuck.
I'm Gerhard Stollinger. I moved in here 9 years ago. I got involved with the wood shop. Chuck was already there as a fixture, but a fixer. And particularly, we relished his ability to fix lamps and things like that. But Chuck left an enduring legacy at LBL in his doorstops. And in the doorstop, the usual wedge, but then it had a hole about 2.5 feet, little ball on top. And so that when you wanted to remove the stop, you didn't have to bend over, you just pulled it up. When Sherry Kenny, when he went to Mikasa, Sherry Kenny saw that, she immediately ordered, I don't know, 30 lighter wood. And Don Hossink was the one who made them all. But you would go into assisted living and Mikasa, and you see in front of his door one of Chuck's doorstops, and they will forever be used here. Thank you, Chuck.
I really do appreciate it very much, although I can't help wondering, what exactly is the statute of limitations on stealing police vehicles? It matters at this point. Just want to remind everybody, we do have refreshments outside in the hallway area there afterwards, and it would be a good opportunity for us to visit a little bit again, even more as family and community, and share.
What's your favorite?
Ice cream and cookies. Ice cream and cookies, Chuck's favorite. Which means you must stay. Let's just have a word of prayer and we'll see where we are. So let's sit together. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for sharing this good man with us for a time. Thank you for the impact that he had in the lives of his wife, his children, grandchildren. Thank you for that big heart that opened itself for others, invited others in as family, and loved them as such. Thank you for sharing this good man with us. Now, Lord, we, of course, have committed him into your hands. but it remains for us to look after one another down here. So I ask that you would give us the grace, as family, as community, to continue to look after one another and help one another, and as needed, fix things, or even fix one another as is needed. Help us to help one another as community. Help us to gather around Mary Ellen and the children and grandchildren, and to continue to love them and watch over them, even as Chuck would if he were still here with us. You watch over him, gave us the grace, Lord, to watch over one another down here. And we look forward to that day when we will be reunited. For this we give you thanks and praise through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you so much for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.